security notion or security threat in the shape or in the form of the current or the present COVID-19 situation, which led to many economic or social devastating character. The state is not so far actively basically engaged to deal with such situations. So we will find differences of state approach regarding the traditional notion of security and the non-traditional aspect of security. Where the traditional aspect of security is concerned, state is very, very much active and state resources have been employed to deal with such situations. So far as the non-traditional security concern is stated, state is a little bit reluctant to deal with or to fight with the causes, fight with the natural emergencies or the natural emergency situation coming out of, for example, the COVID-19 situation. So why state is so silent or so inactive to deal with such situation? It is not only the case of India. If you consider the state around the world, the state is not so much active to deal with the non-traditional security concerns. So the non-traditional security concerns in the shape of the various social problems coming out of different issues, for example, the crisis regarding the food crisis, the migration crisis, the water crisis. There are many issues which are coming under the non-traditional security threats. So the approach to deal with, the state approach to deal with the non-traditional security cases is a little bit very low in comparison to traditional security. Secondly, when we are discussing about the role of state, it is very essential to deal with the concept of state morality versus the concept of societal morality. The concept of state morality, from the perspective of realistic tradition, basically state is moral in the sense that it is the responsibility of the state to protect the citizen and its territory from external threat and aggression. So by use of military means or by use of economic means, the state had to protect its territory or had to protect its citizen from the external threats. State morality, to some extent, is different from the societal morality in the sense that what is good for society may not be good for state, and state is somehow more interested in the field of the interest of its own interest rather than societal interest. The societal interest is very complex and vast, and the state interest is basically limited and more specifically focused on the political viewpoint. And the societal interest basically deals with economic and social aspects. So the state morality and the societal morality in this context is different from each other, and the state is more interested in dealing with the state morality, and in the context of state morality, state is always prepared to protect the citizen and its territory from external threats. So from this perspective, the role of state to deal with such situation can be assessed from two main viewpoints. One is state is an institution of social welfare. In this context, the state looks into the following aspect of individual and societal survival. So first of all, the state is basically institution of social welfare. The basic objective of state had to be to defend the right of the individuals and the liberty of individuals also. The right guaranteed under the Indian Constitution has been protected by the Constitution itself, and it is the duty of the state to respect the constitutional rights of the citizen, and it is also the duty of the state to protect the fundamental right given by the Constitution to the citizen of India. Secondly, how to ensure the provision of social security is also the primary respective primary interest or primary objective of the state. The protection of social security has been one of the crucial arguments regarding the nature of state functioning or the nature of the welfare nature of the state. So provision of social security has been one of the delaying elements in the Indian politics. So during the COVID-19 situation, the vulnerability of heightening social security has been more frontal and focal, so that the state is not sufficiently giving more attention to the concept of social security. Again, the socio-economic reform also one of the basic agenda on part of the welfare, the democratic welfare nature of the state. The socio-economic reforms so far, from the Indian perspective, the last 4-5 years, we have not find any substantial socio-economic changes, which basically affect the economic and social security aspect. For example, regarding the labor issues coming, the migration issues or the labor issues, there is most of labor law so as to engage more laborer coming out of different part of country. So reform, socio-economic reform during the emergency situation is one of the basic fundamental issues which the state has to take into account. So far, the state is unable, the state on part of it is unable to reform the present socio-economic reform so as to engage, so as to accommodate various interest of the coming out of part. So another aspect of the debate and discussion is from the point of social cohesion and integration. So far, social cohesion and integration is concerned, the present 19 COVID situation create an avenue for more social disunity, create more social disunity by giving one type of sectarian politics, by giving one type of sectarian politics to the political arena, which maximizes the interest of the ruling elite. So, equitable allocation of the state resources is concerned, state has to how to distribute its resources, how to provide the relief fund to the affected, basically the affected areas of the society, so as to basically revive the societal norms, including societal integration. So, considering the aspect of the maintenance of justice and the democratic order in the society, the state sometimes uses the force to maintain justice and order in the society. So, maintenance of law and order are purely the hands of the state, and state in this context had to be taken into necessary step as how to the justice system had to be survived and the democratic order had to be restored. So police force is not only the criteria that the state can use to restore social order and maintenance of justice. So these organs of the state now controlled by the action and the reaction of the state. The state is altogether, the state is the basic unit control, it's specialized agencies or institutions which is in some extent defunctioned or defunctioned from the perspective of carry forward its allocated functions or designed functions. So, from the perspective of state as an upholder of absolutism or unlimited state, if you consider state is unlimited, then state has separate or different functions have to perform. if state is not is only a state, then individual liberty and individual freedom had to be at stake. So there will be no individual freedom and individual liberty when the state is unlimited. So the Constitution of India guarantees the state should not be unlimited. That this is a limited state. But during the emergency, the state tend to be more unlimited, keeping in mind the national requirement or the national necessities. So in this context, the main function of the state is to how to maintain law and order, maybe by putting the police forces or by using police forces, whatever may be the instrument that has the state had to be employed. The basic objective is how to restore law and order. So in order to restore law and order situation in the country, the state sometimes uses violence in different forms and different shapes. So, therefore, absolutism in field of emergency is to some extent perpetuate the state centralism. State centralism in the sense of controlling all aspects of individual and societal life for the sake of its power and authority. So, then the second aspect of the discussion had to be state existence versus the societal existence. The societal existence, some extent, has broader connotation and meaning in comparison to state existence. The societal existence, societal integrity, societal interest, some extent, has more application of the state interest. State basically primarily interested to preserve and protect the political aspect of individual life, not and do something which is specific in nature in the field of political aspect, but not in the field of social and economic aspect. So state, when state is basically absolute or unlimited, the aspect of socio-economic justice, the aspect of social solidarity had to be attacked back. So, sometimes the state uses force basically to control about other institutions, which is basically of its own creation. There is no doubt the state has many own creation of institution, which also controlled by the dominance of the state. So the distribution of power system or the distribution of constitutional allocation of resources or the distribution of constitutional allocation of power and authority in the time of emergency or in the time of, for example, the COVID-19 situation is under the control of the state authority. So keeping in mind all these factors, so it is now very essential to deal with what is basically the nature of Indian state and how far the Indian state is successful in dealing with this situation. So before to that extent, I want to discuss some aspect of the state in some aspect of the role of state in comparison to the other association, which is equal weight, which has been given equal weightage in the field of socio-economic development. So if you compare the function of the state and the function of other association, so you find a great divide between state on the one hand and the civil society on the other hand. The civil society, the function performed by the civil society and the function performed by
Hello.
Sir, sound is not coming. Yours.
there is a problem probably.
Maybe internet connection.
Please have patience. He will be connected shortly. Are you there? Please unmute yourself. Yes, sir.
Am I audible? Visible?
Both. You are visible and visible.
Okay. What I am discussing about the supremacy of the state over other associations. So that basically come from the viewpoint of the state and the civil society divide. The civil society, which basically performs the socio-economic functions which affect this life in society, life of the individual and the society linked, are drastically rejected by the state. Because the state had to show its own power and authority in the context of affecting the life of the citizen and the interest of the society. So there is always a debate going on between the sphere of action of the civil society and the sphere of action of the state. So far as the sphere of the action of the state is concerned, the state is very sovereign and state has a vital instrument called law, which state applies to maximize its own interest and to carry forward its own decisions. So far as the civil society is concerned, which performs very vital socio-economic functions affecting individual and societal life, are basically not accessible by the state for the larger interest of the state itself. So the societal interest, which has been shaped and which has been prioritized by the civil society, has been diminished by the state. So far as the state wants to show its muscularity by applying the sovereign power, by applying the sovereign power which has been given by the population as a whole of the state. So law is not the not alone the will of the state, but also sometimes work as a force of the state. So the reformation of law or the changing of the law or the creation of the law is basically the paramount of the state jurisdictions or under the state. So therefore, state sometimes alter the law, sometimes change the law, sometimes make the law to satisfy its own interest over the interest of the society and over the interest of individual and over the interest of both groups. So therefore, the debate and discussion regarding state versus non-state actor in the context of state-society divide has been one of the primary subject of discussion in the realm of political science and in the realm of international relations. The non-state actors in the form of various NGOs, various civil society, various economic and societal institutions, their contribution for the sake of individual life and the sake of individual glory or for the sake of societal interest has been very vital, and the state is not in a position to accept the contribution given by or accept the contribution that basically from the side of the non-state actors or from the side of the civil society. So that another aspect of discussion which basically showed the nature and functioning of the state system or the sovereign state system is whether the state is an egalitarian state or whether the state is an authoritarian state. In comparison to the other nation state of the world, India basically is a democratic state. There is no doubt Indian Constitution guarantee or Indian Constitution acclaimed India as a democratic, sovereign democratic state. There is no doubt about it. But there is a tendency of democratic centralism within broader framework of the constitutional apparatus. So, egalitarian nature of the egalitarian aspect of the nature of state has been dominated by the democratic centralism or the aspect of democratic centralism because the state basically tried to show its nature within the democratic framework by capturing the key element of national resources or by capturing the key element of national politics so it to show its own muscle in order to achieve its own national interest. So when we are talking about absolute state or versus limited state or authoritarian state or democratic state, so India, though constitutionally acclaimed as a democratic state, the functioning, if you can analyze the functioning of the state, you find little bit of centralism and the nature of unlimited state so far as the sovereignty and integrity of the state is concerned. If you apply the first theory of the state, so some extent India is basically designed in such a fashion to use force in different means to attain its own national interest or to attain its national objective in contradiction to the objective of the social apparatus. Again, there is another dimension where you can find the nature of the state in the situation, considering the aspect of whether Indian state is basically a secular state or a theocratic state. So, Indian constitution provides Indian state is a basically secular state. So, there is no state religion in India, and state is neutral in this aspect of the religious matter which affects the society and the individual. However, some extent state policing of religion, we found state policing of religion and state preferences of some religion over other religion, or how state is basically prepared to mold the ethical or religious life of the society, and how state is basically tempted to mold or to reframe the mindset of the individual or the mindset of the society from the perspective of the religion or the ethical value system of its own connotations. So therefore, the theocratic nature, the secular nature of the Indian state has been, in some extent, has been criticized by many scholars and many scholars in this field. And the working of Indian constitution of more than 60 years shows that theoretically there is no doubt India is a secular state, but in some extent, the state has its own religious affiliations, or the state has its own cultural value system or own ethical value system which the state wants to impose on the citizen, on the society in some cases. Keeping in the COVID-19 situation, the state is very much interested to policing the religion affairs, policing the cultural or the ethical affairs, and state is some extent designed to give its own version of the religious affair or the religious sanctions. So, in considering individual rights versus state authority, the state authority is unlimited, when the state authority is unlimited, there is no doubt there is no space for individual rights and freedom. So state authority, the nature of the state authority provides basically whether there should be more right to the individual or there should be less right to the individual. If the state is more authoritarian, there is little space or there is no space for the individual rights to life and liberty, the individual right to the basically the to constitutional remedy, the individual right to go to the court or the justice system. So whatever be the case, when the state authority is unlimited, naturally the individual rights is limited, and there is limitation posed or imposed by the state for in the sake of public safety or in the sake of public interest. In the pretext of the public safety and public interest, the state wants to maximize its own power over the issues of fundamental rights affecting individual life and individual liberty. So life and survival, the right to life and right to survival now in the hands of the states. So state can modify the life of the individual, life of the society at its own discretion, and the society had to obey the law of the state and the individual had to obey the law of the state. So far if it's a limited state, so there is ample space of the right of the society, the right of the individual, the right of the group to determine how they would save their own interest, how they would maintain their own interest, what is good for their own interest and what is good for their own interest also. Therefore, the nature of the state, whether state authority is limited or state authority is unlimited, depends basically upon the nature and functioning of the state. So individual right in the context of the nature of the state also determine how its own position will be in the context of the state action and reactions. So when we are viewing state as a coordinator of the interest of the society and state as a conciliator of the interest of the society. So we find that there are other associations. State similarly is one of the associations having sovereignty, having the force of law and having the constitutional sanctity. So state coordinate different interests of the society or the state conciliate different interests of the society. So far as the coordination aspect or the coordination function of the state is concerned, the state in this context is a little biased towards the interest of the marginal section of the society and the interest of the richer or the older section of the society. The coordinating interest of different interests of the society has been the vital aspect of state function and to the state jurisdiction. So coordination aspect, the state is largely failed to coordinate different aspects of the different interests and aspects of the society so as to make the society more healthy and more prosperous. Therefore, one-dimensional approach of the state, the unilateral action of the state or the unilateral approach of the state is very much seen in the context of the COVID-19. So state is reluctant to take the advice of the civil society or take the voices or take the approaches from the civil society and the NGOs so as to ensure a better administrative or so ensure a better economic system. Therefore, state as a coordinating interest of the society, or state as a coordinator of different interests of the society, depends upon the functioning and the capability of the state also. In the context of keeping in mind India, in the Indian context, state as a coordinator of different interests has largely failed to accommodate all this interest of the society in the context of the COVID-19 situation. Another aspect in this context is basically whether state is a rational entity or state is an irrational entity. So state in the dictum of foreign policy, so state is basically a rational entity. So rationality, state rationality means the maximization of state interest in the cost of minimum resources. So maximization of interest. So what interest the state has to serve? The interest of the state alone, or the interest of the society, or the interest of the individual, or the interest of the group? That is also a question. State always act according to the rational strategy or the rational theory that the state always try to maximize its own interest in the cost of the minimum use of minimum national resources. The state rationality and the societal rationality, some extent, is different from each other. So in the context of India, the decision-making apparatus, which should be basically in rational nature or democratic nature, that the 4 months of the COVID-19 situation witnessed a very pathetic aspect, that the decision-making apparatus is not more democratic in nature. So the procedure should be more democratic, so that the decision of the state will be more democratic. If the procedure is undemocratic, that may lead to an undemocratic decision. So the decision-making apparatus or decision-making procedure of the state in India is, during the last 4 or 5 months, is not in par with the different other aspect of the society. There are different other organizations, associations that have to be taken into interest. Their views also have to be taken into consideration, while the state is intent to make decision affecting national or international politics. So therefore, in this context of the rationality, the rational mode of decision making, the context of the Indian context, if you examine the Indian context, it witnesses that some extent the state is so much irrational, and the procedure of the decision making is so much irrational. So far as the state handling of the social problems is concerned, socio-economic problems is concerned, I think in the context of India, the state is largely a failure in dealing with the social problems or in dealing with the economic problems coming out of different fields. The state had to take into account the contribution of the non-state actor by forging partnership with the non-state actors. The state always want to deal with the issues alone, so that there will be a great problem in the field of dealing with social and economic problems. So the creation of more vulnerable social and economic problems can be tackled with the active participation or the active partnership of the non-state actors with the state actors. So state had to take into account the claims, the approaches of the non-state actors, so as to revive, also to develop a holistic approach to deal with the socio-economic problems confronting India today. Regarding the control of the control of state on individual life and the social existence, state always tried to control the basic basic objective. State always tried to control the organization, the association, which has been meant for or which has been designed to promote the socio-economic interest of individuals. The state tried to control because the state tried to control to show its size of muscularity, or so that the state is only supreme institution in the society, and the supremacy, to show the supremacy of the state, and the state in this context always tried to show its supremacy, and the unilateral approach of the state is the basic threat or problem to a democratic society and a democratic institutions. Keeping in mind, Hello, Suprajit, can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. In the conclusion, I will submit basically my lecture by concluding this. In my conclusion, I must say that in India, this state so far played a very crucial role, no doubt about it. But the state had to take the interest of other association, or the approaches of other association, and the unilateral approaches of the state had to be abandoned, and state in the context of dealing with such problems, state had to take the views and the approaches from different aspects of the society, or different organs of the society, or different association, religious, cultural, whatever may be, that the state had to accommodate their interest with the own interest, with the state interest also. So far as the health system of the state is concerned, the health system and the policy, there is a huge policy gap regarding the health system of this country is concerned. So health system, there should be proper sanitization system, there should be compulsory mask system, there should be strictly containment procedure, whether the containment is, and the there is also, so the state had to look at whether it is a, the scientific the approach should be very scientific, and the scientific figure based on the view of technocrats, views of the scientists, rather than purely the bureaucrats. So state had not to be taken into the only the views of the bureaucrats by discarding the views of the technocrats and the specialists. The specialist general views regarding the administration of the state, so state had to take a look at a balancing rule to accommodate the specialist views on the one hand and the generalist views on the other hand. So the technocrats, the views of the technocrats or the scientists should be taken into consideration, keeping in by the volatile nature of the COVID-19 situation. Thank you, Satrajit.
Thank you, sir, for giving speech. First of all, I would like to request participants and other resource person, if they are present, if some of them has any query or question to you.
Hello, sir. My name is Anjay. I have a question to Professor Bigel. Recently, we have seen that in America, USA, and both in India, that they are have a major shift from popular sovereignty to absolute sovereignty. The states system. So, whether do you think that in absolute sovereign states, if India is not an absolute sovereignty, so if you think that our social contracts needs to be rewritten and reshaped in previous decades? Thank you.
For your question. So, India is not an absolute state. So, if you analyze the functioning, or if you analyze the constitutional mode of the functioning of the state, you find that India is not an absolute state. It's basically a limited state. It's a limited state in the sense that state has given space for individual survival. State has given space for development of other associations. State has given space for the other aspect of individual life, for example, the religious, social, and the cultural aspect of the individual and social life. State is not absolute in the sense that state is guided by, state action is guided by the constitutional norms. So, if the state is unconstitutional or unlimited, then in the form of the voice of population will be there. So the voice of population always act as a ventilating measure to rectify whether the government is authoritarian or the state is authoritarian or not. So in emergency situation, some extent the state, the limited nature of the state is become the unlimited nature of state. So to deal with the emergency or the situation which is pose danger to the national security, the national economy, the security of the state or the security of individual, the security of the society, state become more aggressive and state become more unlimited. So constitutionally or theoretically, India is a basically a limited state, not a unlimited state.
Thank you, sir.
Any other participants have any other question or query to Dr. Bijay Kumar Das? He or she may ask him directly or can type it on the chat box. I think there is no more questions for Dr. Bijay Kumar Das. I must conclude the session by saying that Sir has brought several important issues in his lectures, starting from recognizing the nature of the pandemic as non-traditional security issue and the state's initiative to address the non-traditional security threats and state and society interface. And he also deals with the role of the liberal state or state's response to contain the pandemic. And he has rightly mentioned state is involved in dealing with two different kinds of security issues, like traditional and the non-traditional security issues. And in case of dealing with the traditional security issue, the state is equipped enough. But with regard to the non-traditional security threat, state is inadequate and reliant. And one important thing he has mentioned in his lecture that the Indian state fails to address the rise of pandemic since the socio-economic frame is not adequate enough to deal with the menace. And he also mentioned the role that can be played by state and civil society organization to deal with the situation. Actually, as state has to play a predominant role given the resources and equipment it has, there is a growing tendency of centralization of power, which in reality resulting in violating some of the constitutional rights of the individual. Dr. Dash, in his paper, also raised the debate of collective versus individual, that is, between state and individuals. And since the state coordinates different interests of society, it has a very responsible role to play. And it's true Now it is a challenge before the state, as he has rightly put, how to accommodate the various demands of the society or adjust individual interests, which has been jeopardized by the wake of pandemic. Now I am concluding the session. Before concluding this, I just ask you if any of the participants have any question to Dr. Bijay Kumar Das sir. I think there is no question for sir. Kaushik da.
Hello. Yes. Yes, Dr. Banerjee.
Yes,
please start our next technical session.
Okay. Sir, stay with us. Bijay sir, please stay with us. He will be sharing the next session.
Yes, yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. This is the first technical question of the third day of Physical Science, Bankura University. And this is technical station number 5, and first of all I'd like to check whether all the paper presenters are present or not. Dr. Dona Ganguly. Dr. Dona Ganguly. Next, Joy Prakash Mandol. Joy Prakash Mandol, Head of the Department, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science, Bangladesh Evening College. Are you there? Next is Dr. Shravan Kumar, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science. Are you online?
Yes, yes, Dr. Sir.
Okay, thank you.
Very good morning, sir. My yes. Greeting to all. Yes, sir.
Okay, just stay tuned. I'm just taking whether all the paper presenters are present or not.
Oh, okay.
Mr. Dhananjay Shaha, Research Scholar, Presidency University.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I am present.
Okay. Next is Shufal Bhattari. Mr. Devkumar Singh and Robert Kai, you can mute your microphones.
Hello. In order to respond to your call, presence, I switch on my microphone. Yes, I am Devkumar Singh. I am present here.
Okay. And Shufal Vyapari? Shufal Vyapari. M.A. appearing Department of Political Science, Rabindra Bharati University, is not present. Dr. Saifuzzaman. Dr. Saifuzzaman, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science, Government General Degree College, Baja.
I am present.
Okay.
Yes, present.
Okay. It's noted, sir. And Dipmar, sir, also. Mentioned that he is present. And Solomon Peck, MA fourth semester student, Department of Political Science, Bankura University. Solomon, are you there? Oh.
Now we have only
Dr. Banerjee. Dr. Banerjee.
Yes.
Soleiman is present. Soleiman is present.
Okay. Now we have with us paper presenters Dr. Shravan Kumar, Mr. Dhananjay Shah, Dr. Saifuzzaman, Mr. Deep Kumar Singh, and Soleiman Sheikh. If I miss some other's name, no. Dr. Tona Ganguly and Joy Prakash Mandal is not, they are not present. Dr. Bijoy Kumar Das, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, can I just begin?
Yes, we can now start this, sir.
Okay. So, I'd like to call first.
Dr. Not present. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Two speakers are not present.
We should start with Dr. Shravan Kumar, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science, Nalanda College, B.I. Sharif.
Okay, go ahead, by inviting Shravan Kumar.
He is now Dr. Shravan Kumar.
Yes, sir. Very good move, sir.
Okay. Because I'm in this case, you can see, sir.
Hello.
Yes, you are not well.
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, you are audible.
Am I audible? Okay, sir. Very good morning to all. My greeting to all the honorable members associated with this webinar, myself, Dr. Shravan Kumar, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science, Nalanda College, Bihar Sharif. The topic of my research paper is India's neighborhood policy during pandemic situation. The objective of this research paper is to find out how India's foreign policy is changing with neighboring countries in this year of global pandemic. How can the changing global scenario make its unique identity with this pandemic? India is an important country in South Asia at a time when the world is going through a global epidemic called COVID-19, an opportunity for India to redefine relations with its neighbors and the country's neighborhood. There is a challenge to restore the relations of US policy. There is no doubt that India is as much plagued by the epidemic as other countries in South Asia. If there is something different in this situation, it is that India is doing better in dealing with this epidemic than in the West. Many countries of the world are struggling with the coronavirus crisis at this time. Everyone is trying to every possible way to get out of it. At the same time, in the hour of this crisis, India is not only helping the neighboring countries, but also helping the countries around the world. All such member countries are troubled by the coronavirus epidemic. India has supplied hydrochloroquine drugs to 55 countries, including the US, and as a part of policy to help friendly countries in the intense crisis. India has also dispatched medicine to neighboring countries, Pakistan, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Nepal, Maldives, Sri Lanka, and Myanmar. For corona affected areas, India evacuated not only its citizens, but also citizens of more than 100 countries. These include countries such as Maldives, Myanmar, Bangladesh, China, USA, Nepal, South Africa, and Sri Lanka. Coronavirus continues to break havoc in all SAARC countries, including India. So far, no effective drug has been found to treat patients infected with the coronavirus. In such a situation, an important measure to deal with corona is better management of the steps being taken to prevent this epidemic. To this end, India has launched an e-platform in partnership with SAARC countries, sharing experiences with health professionals on issues related to management and strategy, so that SAARC countries can benefit from each other's experiences to fight the coronavirus. In fact, it is known that in South Asia, problems like political instability, conflict, lack of connectivity, causes stalemate and mistrust in relations with neighboring countries. In addition, China's intervention in this country makes it more complicated. Another psychological reason behind this can also be seen. Ecological fear arises in neighboring countries regarding India's large size and economy, which appears to be trying to balance through China. It needs to be understood here that South Asia is a complex region. The countries of this region have shared heritage and historical relationship. At the same time, variations in the religious, ethnic, linguistic, and political fabric of these countries are also reflected. Asia has been a battlefield of bloodlined interstate wars and civil wars, having a witness to liberation movement, nuclear rivalries, military dictatorship, and has suffered from extremist religious fundamentalism and terrorism, besides serious problems related to drug trafficking and human trafficking. The constituent countries range between a flexible secular mindset and rigid conservation on the criteria of religious tolerance. South Asia is considered to be one of the lowest commonly in the world, despite a long time the start recorded very slow and sluggish progress is. India adopted an independent policy, foreign policy, independence, and prioritized harmonious and friendly relations with neighboring countries and other countries of the world while advancing global peace. This is why India, instead of being part of particular factions during the Cold War, called the non-aligned movement forward. In the changing global order, India adopted Lucas policy in order to promote economic activity with Southeast Asian countries. Apart from this, India also worked on the policy of unilateral extension to its smaller neighbors under the Gujarat team. The present government has given priority to the neighborhood first policy while maintaining the elements of continuity in current policy as well as making it more dynamic according to the current circumstances. The neighborhood first policy also maintains the elements of continuity existence in Indian foreign policy, recognizing the priority of Gujarat doctrine, emphasizing global peace, friendship, and amicable relations. India has friendly relations with most of the neighboring countries, but at times it is affected by global conditions and regional events. Talking about relations with neighboring countries, India currently has good relations with Afghanistan. India is playing a major role in capacity building there, but Taliban activities remain a matter of concern here. India also has good social cultural relations with Nepal. Nepal's internal situation and China's presence here negatively affected. India has always had friendly and cordial relations with Bhutan and Nepal. Their relations are progressive relations with Bangladesh and Myanmar and advancing at a rapid pace, but China's presence is also affecting relations here. China wants to establish its influence on the trade route of the Indian Ocean. In such a situation, China is working on a strategy to encircle India under the string of false policy with the intention of providing economic assistance to India's neighboring countries. Therefore, in order to counterbalance China and South Asia, the role of neighboring countries increased greatly. A realistic approach has been adopted by India to control the world order, regional equilibrium, and the behavior of China, which is playing with sovereignty of the Southeast Asia, of the Asia Pacific. In the last few months, in the midst of the corona epidemic, India strengthened its security cycle with direct investment from China and other neighboring countries. This move of India greatly integrated China. In this way, the COVID disaster has now over a changing world order where efforts are being made to create a global image through the politics of generosity in the midst of the acquisition. The struggle to elevate its global status is also being seen in the post-corona period through politics. The politics of the corona disaster has exposed America's weakness and the global role of India, which also have a greater image as soft power, and in recent years has come to be seen as important economic, military, and financial forces. India has been looking for an innovative role in global politics, and in this direction, recently there was a meeting of several countries in place in under the leadership of America, which has to bring transparency past the origin of COVID-19. Its next focus was to criticize China's negative role in COVID-19. But in all areas that the U.S. has weakened due to the COVID, and that the weakening of the U.S. will give a further boost to the ambitious management domination policies. At the same time, as China has been adopting a policy of encircling India, its borders, and neighborhoods for the last few years, this includes China and
Dr. Conrad, just interrupting. You have only 1 minute left.
Okay, sir. As far as India's neighborhood policy is concerned, India today has the power to beat China on all fronts on its own. The situation now is that in the case of Galwan and Ladakh, with our status, Nepal understood that this is a new and prosperous India with difficult high nausea. In last, that will deal with this will play a major role in the changing global politics. India should set up a special task force with its neighboring countries and regional organizations such as and the state. So in that there is no lack of coordination and communication in preparations to deal with this disaster. As per Jane, the whole world is going through a several crises. This is not the time to acquire, but to show solidarity and that is visual enemy. The global superpower should match ever efforts towards the best possible prevention of this and making optimal job there. Thank you very much.
My only suggestion is to when we are dealing with the neighborhood policy, just select one country. So far, India has created many neighborhoods. So India has listened with many neighbors and has number of problems India has confronting with the neighbors country. So when we are discussing the neighborhood policy, take one country and India's relation with that particular one country. So the research will be very good. So you can't at a time discuss the India's policy, China, policy towards Pakistan, India's policy towards Nepal, in Bhutan. So the policy of India is not similar to that. You are not in a position to deal with the whole country's neighborhood country, the relation of India with the whole neighborhood country. So select one country and if possible, select one problem India, that will be very pertinent lecture or to have a discussion.
Thank you,
Sankar. Very good paper.
Thank you,
Dr. Sankar. Now, Dhananjay Shah.
Yes, I am present.
Okay. You may not now present your paper, and Dhananjay Shah is a research scholar at Dillon University, and he is going to present his paper on India's foreign policy in pandemic situation with Bhutan.
Yes, sir. With due respect to Chair Professors, Professor Vijay Kumar Das, and my gratitude to all of the Bankura University Department of Political Science members. And very good afternoon. And my topic is India's neighborhood policy during pandemic situation with Bhutan. In recent times, we have been saying converse relations with China on the border conflict issue and Nepal as a buffer state going India's tension. Therefore, in this crisis, India tries to negotiations and showing power that India has potentially to work. At this juncture, India exercising to get support of neighbor state for setback China. So Bhutan is a truly example who stand beside India. So my article focuses on the economy, health and political aspect, which incorporated India with Bhutan to bound deep friendship in this pandemic crisis. India is a country which had larger partition history with a neighbor at the time of independence. Its statehood and peace always made it a great example of larger democracy. Non-violence and non-aggression lies with there has many denigrate lessons learned from history. Despite all of this, India has shared high degrees of friendly ties. Party concepts like Alpha, United Liberation Front of Assam, NDLB, National Democratic Front of Bodoland and Kamthapur movement as a threat for India and Bhutan. And India provides this financial assistance by providing financial assistance to Bhutan and constructed major highways and hydroelectric project. India yielding to economic assistance to Bhutan and extensible to the development needs. And there are many security concerns for both India and Bhutan's rely on these aspects. So after winning the 2019 elections, Prime Minister Modi visited to Bhutan with his external minister, national security advisors, and foreign secretary, along with the senior officials, to inaugurate the foundational stone of Holongchu hydropower project and constructed Supreme Court building. And while Modi's visit sent a clear signal about how important neighbors are India, and the Modi government was voted back to the power on May 2019, the heads of the BIMSTEC countries, including Bhutan, attends Modi's opening ceremony. And these political engagements have indeed heralded a new phase of bilateral relationship between India and Bhutan. COVID-19 pandemic situation and border dispute. COVID-19 brought social health systems and economies of the world to their knees, and bringing all the activities to a half, albeit majority of the affected being highly developed countries. And the global shutdown has sent the world economies into tailspin. And the stock exchange and global markets have seen their largest drop. The coronavirus pandemics not only affect economic resilience, but also democratic rights and values. Every country's development depends on the trade relations, so India has been trying exports of goods to make the pandemic situation. Another concern is the border disputes of countries now being a controversial point. China had been amassing troops and armament along the line of actual control for nearly 2 months. People's Liberation Army of China attacking on Indian troops while they are patrolling in the border of China. These deadly clashes at Galwan Valley and the ongoing stand of Chinese to demand Pangong Saw as their territory, which is a threat to our sovereignty. This conflict was similar type which had emerged in Doklam. The Sino-Indian violent face-off at the disputed site of Ladakh appears to have changed a strategic calculus in South Asia. Countries in the Indian subcontinent are finding it difficult to balance between India and China. Similar countries, Nepal, sided with a passing a bill into parliament by including the Kalapani territory, and these are the continuous intimidation of territorial sovereignty of India. And Indian neighbor and true friend Bhutan fall this strategic rivalry between two giants. And the Himalayan kingdom Bhutan is also facing a test in balancing her southern and northern neighbor. And China has now claimed the Sakding Wildlife Sanctuary, which located in eastern Bhutan at the Global Environmental Facility, a multilateral international initiative that works in partnerships of United Nations during discussions in June on a project for a sanctuary. For a sanctuary, this China described it as a disputed territory, and the claim at once rejected by Thimphu, which had that Sakding sanctuary is an integral and sovereign territory of Bhutan. And at no point during the boundary discussion between the two nations has it features as a disputed area. The COVID-19 pandemic and economic resolution in Bhutan. Even as the COVID-19 pandemic has hit the world's none other before it, the Himalayan Kingdom of Bhutan has done well in keeping the number of infection at 92, and 83 are recovered. As a country, its death rate is zero, and only 9 active cases bring a success to fight against this pandemic. Till 21st July, worldometer informations with two cases reported yet. And the World Bank has brought down Bhutan's GDP's growth rate projections from 2.2 to 2.9% from the pre-COVID-19 projections of 6.5. The small South Asia... Yes, sir.
Your time is about to over.
Okay, sir. I am now concluding. So, COVID-19 pandemic has severely affected the Bhutan's economic stability, that Bhutan as a tourist place, where every countries, however, from India and every neighboring countries are visited to Bhutan from tourist facilities. And there, the World Bank has flagged that the agricultural, construction and export sectors like that badly hit in the labor shortages and the hydropower, tourism, agriculture remains the larger contributors to the nation's economy being adversely affected. So, in this India profile, the infrastructural input like hydroelectricity, roads, construction, base metals, minerals, products, machinery for growth and development of economy. Recently, External Affairs Minister Subramaniam Jaishankar assured to Bhutan assistance from India. The New Delhi assured that both countries fight together dealing with the challenges of post-global crisis. So, India had a, concluding that India had a growing opportunity to overcome both countries, India and Bhutan, being focused on the territorial integrity, mutual cooperation, negotiation to fight against this commonly enemy during this pandemic. Well, so my argument is that, in concluding, that India and Bhutan is now focusing on the strong relationship, both of them, to fight this pandemic and fight this situation of Indo-Sino-Indian border dispute. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shaha. Sir, if you have some suggestions or comment to me.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
You presented very brilliantly some aspect of the security concerns and some aspect of the ties between Bhutan and India. And also you projected in your paper that Bhutan plays a balancing role between the relation between China and India. So do you find that this balancing role is tilt toward India or tilt toward China?
Is balancing towards India, because in 2 days, in few after days, that External Affairs Minister said that in Bhutan is currency in blue term 400 million offered to 400 crore offered to Bhutan to fight this pandemic situation, and India decides Bhutan's health and economic crisis, and External Affairs Ministers have trying to say this, that we stand with Bhutan's policy. So I'm thinking that in this Sino-Indian relation dispute and that COVID-19 pandemic, that outbreak from China have a major impact in the world, and India is focusing on trying to establishing the strengthened relationship with its neighboring countries like Bhutan, and Bhutan is a major pivotal role to play. And Dr. Lotai Shering, the Prime Minister of Bhutan, also assured India to keep beside the boot of India's India's territorial sovereignty. So I think.
Thank you, Dhananjay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Sir.
So, Mr. Super Vapari, I think he is not there. He is not present. And next, I'm going to call Dr. Saifur Zaman.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yeah.
And Dr. Saifur Zaman is an assistant professor, Department of Political Science, Government General Degree College, Manbajar, Purulia. And he is going to present the paper on Modi era and Sino-Indian relations. Sir, start your paper.
Yes, sir.
And please stick to 8 minutes schedule. Try.
Thank you, sir. Very good afternoon. Myself, Safu Zaman. My topic is concerned the Modi era and Sino-India relation. My paper basically highlights the changing natures of India-China relationship during the Modi era. But before I highlighted my main point, I just highlight the chronology of development of India-China relation. India and China both are two most populous countries in the world, which have legacy of ancient culture and civilization. Despite a number of similarities, both have many times originated to themselves at different end, especially on bilateral continuous issue. Despite the fact that India was one of the first few countries to recognize the People's Republic of China as the legitimate government of China on 1st April 1940. During the era of 1948, during the Nehru era, both the nations were able to reach the consensus of signs of Panchil Agreement, which became the guiding principle of India-China bilateral relation. However, during the decade of 1959 to 76, the hostilities grew up between the both the countries, which saw the bad pitch in the relationship during the war of 1962. In that time, the very special relationship between China and Pakistan emerging the initiating the Naxalist violence in India reflected of China's policy toward India during India-Pakistan War of 1956 and 1970, and so on. During the 76 to 1988, where both the nations made a maximum effort to dismissing doubt and misunderstanding. The year of 1976 was a landmark year in the India-China relations because both the countries have been able to restore their diplomatic tie by restoring their ambassador. In the period during 98 to 1998 has been characterized the period creating of new atmosphere and trust in India-China bilateral relation. In the ice in the relationship was broken when then Prime Minister of India, Rajiv Gandhi, visited China in December 1988. It was historic because the Prime Minister of India was visiting China after more than three decades. The detention of nuclear device by India in May 1998 to a great extent revived a lot of criticism from the China. Then Prime Minister of India, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, in 2003, opened a number of new views for cooperation. In the Prime Minister Manmohan Singh era, the Chinese President Hu Jintao visited in India 2006 and Prime Minister Manmohan Singh the visit China 2009 could not make a much impact on the bilateral relationship because of different of mistrust of the both the sides. However, the few point roadmap brought up the enhance of strategic relations of a lot of problem and there. Now in Modi era, the India-China relationship, that's major highlight. India Prime Minister Narendra Modi and the right-wing BJP Bharatiya Janata Party was won a powerful mandate in India's 2014 and 2019 general election. Much before he became Indian Prime Minister, Narendra Modi was already a self-voiced admirer of China. He said in 2011, quote, that China and its people have a special place in my heart. I admire their hard-working discipline and resilient nature, and above all, their sense of history. Modi ji is the only prime minister who made 9 official visits to China, 5 times as a prime minister of India and the 4th time as a chief minister of Gujarat. During the Modi's first term in 2014 to 2019, India clearly recognized that its strategic interest in Asia would be best served by beating off United States. However, beyond the great power rivalry constraint, Modi will carry forward the complex bilateral agenda with China in his second term. The Modi's second term, being a turbulent global contest with no sign that either was United States or China was unilaterally relent in the bilateral competition that exist between them. In the year of 2020, marked the 70th anniversary of establishment of diplomatic relations between India and China. It meant to be a year of celebration. But the first, the COVID-11 pandemic, and now the bloody showdown in Galwan, where 20 of Indian Army personnel lost their life, that exposed the tragic irony of those plans. The current disagreement is strategic between both the countries in some three and four sub-sector areas. That's there's some problem that means Despong, Galwan, Hot Spring, Pangontosa, that's a sub-area. India maybe lose that territory. According to the recent Business Standard report in 18 July, that in Despong area, India maybe lose the territory 16 to 18 kilometers. In Galwan area, sector Galwan area, 1 kilometer, and Hot Spring area, 1 to 3 kilometer, and Pangontosa, the 10 kilometer territorial loss. It is a very bad sign, and the challenges for Indian sovereignty is a concern. So that in conclusion in my paper, because lack of time, the challenge of India, China, rubbing up against each other, as Nehru said long ago, is one that run across the span of Asia. A conflict between India and China had implications that go far beyond our border. It is ultimate that in this 70th year of establishment diplomatic relations between them, peaceful coexistence have been replaced by the armed coexistence. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Saiful Jamal. It is a very wonderful lecture from we have heard. If someone has any question or query to Dr. Saiful Jamal.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. I can hear you, sir.
Saiful Jamal, regarding your paper, India, China, basically the territorial issue, very specifically the border issue. So you have mentioned that India is going to lose some territorial space in competition with India, China, and China is now surrounding the border in border of which India claims itself. It is India. So do you find any solution on part of the bilateral relation between India and China? How to settle the dispute?
Yes. Sir, in my opinion, for the serious dialogue, the serious dialogue is the only solution between India-China relations. Not in dialogue between, I think, between the both the Prime Minister and Chinese President, and seriously, that is a serious issue. And
Hello, Dr. Saiful Jamal. Hello, Dr. Saiful Jamal.
Sir. Yes. Technical problem, sir.
Okay, it's absolutely all right. You may continue. Hello. Vijay sir, do you have something to say regarding what he said in reply to his argument or suggestions? Do you have anything to say?
Satrajit, hello. Satrajit, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Let the other speaker to speak. Please invite the other speaker.
Okay, sir. Okay. Now, may May I request Dr. Deb Kumar Singho, Assistant Professor, Malda College, Malda, to present his paper. And his paper is on nature of Sino-Indian relations during COVID-19. To you, sir.
Okay, thank you. And I'm sorry to say that I have some problems in my internet. I don't have required speed. So I'm bound to, situation compelled me to switch off, to keep my video switch off. Otherwise, my voice audio will be flickering. Okay.
It's absolutely all right. You may proceed, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir, respected chair and my colleagues. So already my the title of my paper is declared, The Nature of Sino-India Relations During COVID-19. And we know, all of us know, that the relationship between, the bilateral relationship between India and China is not good. It's a bitter relation. It scuffles, transgression, incursion, distrust, and so on. These are the features. All these things have become the features of the bilateral relationship between India and China. Now, in the meantime, a new flavor added by COVID-19 in the relationship between India and China. The outbreak of COVID-19 is bringing forth significant economic, geopolitical, and perceptual challenges to their already fragile bilateral ties. While the full ramification of the pandemic remains unclear, in the light of recent events, it seems likely that India-China ties would be, in the coming years, be troubled by trade issues, national power competition, and negative Indian perspectives of China. Now, the pandemic already have shaken the commercial peace underlying Sino-Indian relations. Their bilateral trade contracted by 12.4% in the first 2 months of the year due to the coronavirus-related economic slowdown in both the countries. This could potentially be compounded by the suspension of trade and business events planned to mark the 70th anniversary of the establishment of diplomatic ties, which would be a setback to efforts to promote investor confidence and facilitate engagement between the business groups of both the countries. For New Delhi and Beijing, which have conventionally relied on the economic integration and interdependence to constrain conflictual aspects of their bilateral ties, declining trade volume indicates falling economic exchange that in turn could reduce the incentive to cooperate and make ties vulnerable to disruption at the lowest level of the provocation. Additionally, measures to rejuvenate each nation's respective economy in the wake of pandemic may devolve into the economic zero-sum game between the two as they compete more aggressively for supply chains, export markets, and foreign investments. The first signs of discord are already evident. India's decision to revise its foreign direct investment policy to prevent against the opportunistic takeover of Indian companies due to COVID-19 has drawn a sharp reaction to Beijing, from which it has perceived the action as anti-China. Beijing has not yet responded to the New Delhi's plans to merge as an alternative to China in the pharmaceutical drug market, or quote, companies planning to shift production out of China. But as this economic competition intensifies, China might retaliate by refusing to address the current trade imbalances with India, hurting Indian exports and indirectly impacting the Indian job market. China might even consider strengthening Pakistan economically and militarily in order to counter India's influence, economic interests, which for long had been mitigating factor in the Sino-Indian rivalry, could become a new source of tension going forward. With both China and India eager to play a leadership both in the pandemic, simmering soft power competition between them is underway in South Asia through medical diplomacy. New Delhi has stepped up efforts to project a humanitarian image in the region by using the strength of military power to aid neighbors in the early days of the crisis. The Indian Air Force provided essential overseas evacuation assistance to nationals of Bangladesh, Maldives, Sri Lanka, and Nepal. And as the crisis deepened, consignments of essential medical supplies and life-saving drugs were flown to those countries. Now, the negative Indian perceptions of China. At the outset of the pandemic, the Indian government appeared reserved in condemning China for its role in the spread of COVID-19. However, later actions by the Indian government, such as an official from the Indian Council of Medical Research blaming China's equipment for setbacks in combating the coronavirus, have demonstrated its growing resentment towards China. Delays in receiving diagnostic kits from China due to export limits by Beijing, as well as the failure of Chinese protective equipment to meet the Indian standard, has caused a considerable exasperation with the Indian administration. Just recently, India has cancelled an order of 500,000 Chinese test kits after they were found faulty. So additionally, the government decided to reduce reliance on China by expanding indigenous product of testing kits and protective equipments. These actions have become symbolic of the Indian government's frustration with China's perceived culpability in the outbreak of pandemic and lack of integrity in helping the neighbors. China's reaction to these events has been mixed, suggesting a caution approach in dealing with New Delhi. On the other hand, Beijing has officially protested against some of India's measures, calling indiscriminatory, irresponsible, and unfair. And this Chinese state media Global Times warned that the consequences of stigmatization of China. But on the other hand, the state media has also published open discussing in the importance of the benefits of India-China trade with this Chinese ambassador to India, Mr. Shan Weidong. This diplomatic squabbling and public anger indicates that the pandemic reinforced India's feeling of distrust of China in the months ahead, as the economic and geopolitical competition between them intensifies. Their negative perceptions of each other may exacerbate the hostility and the relationship of India and China. Now, although these challenges are not new to the Indo-China relationship, they have been exacerbated by the pandemic. In order to prevent this escalation of these manageable differences into upright conflict, some measures can be considered. Now, just I am pointing out the measures. Number one, both Beijing and New Delhi would have to
give utmost importance to sustaining Sino-Indian economic and trade ties. And number two, as the possibility of interstate tensions due to regional power competition arises, military-to-military communications could be strengthened to build mutual trust and understanding. And number three, to mitigate the impact of negative public perceptions on the bilateral ties, India and China could plan cultural exchanges between their people to dispel such narratives. Such measures would help in building interstate confidence and may mitigate the competitive aspects of India and China relationship. Yes, I have finished. Hello. Thank you.
Are you finished? Have you completed your
question? Yeah, finished.
Okay. Vijay, sir, your observation or comment?
Sir, I can't hear you, sir.
Yes,
it's flickering.
It is a very good paper. You have touched on the territorial aspect, the economic dimensions of China-India relations, and also you have also gone through the different phase of India China bilateral relations till today.
Right, sir.
You have mentioned two pertinent issues regarding the economic relations. When the political relation is out of control or the animosity between two countries regarding the political dimension, basically regarding the issues of the territorial dispute, any confidence building measure to restore their economic relations in this context?
Yes, sir, there is a discontent regarding economic relation because of, electronic devices, so many electronic devices are banned from China. We are not exporting, even we are not buying from market. And the apps, you know, already 59 apps already have been banned. And very recently, 49 apps are going to be banned. And in future, 275 apps India decided to ban from China. So it's a big hit for China in terms of economic business, because India became the economic market of China.
Import of China relations to India. That it's negatively impact on Indian economy?
For the timing, yes, there is apparently it is seeming a negative impact, but the Indian people for the timing will suffer in the unavailability of some goods, you know, rather I should say the fragile goods, because Chinese goods are fragile, not long lasting. But India will recover. Pardon, sir?
But the coronavirus is long lasting.
So yeah, sir. And so we are hopeful. We can hope that coronavirus is also, because as it is made of China. Sorry, I don't have any clear idea on that, sir.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Next presenter. Hello. Hello.
Thank you, Devkumar Singh, sir. It is in the nice presentation. And now I am proceeding to the next speaker. The next speaker is our student from Bankura University. And is Mr. Suleman Sheikh. Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Oh,
sir,
and we can... Please unmute yourself, except the paper presenter. Please unmute yourself, except the paper presenter, unless there is unnecessary noises.
Yes,
and Mr. Soleman Sheikh is going to present paper on changing nature of Sino-Indian relation during COVID-19 period. Soleman, you can
initiate. Yes, sir. Respected chairperson, sir, and special lecturer, Professor Bijay Kumar, sir, respected. My paper title name is Changing Nature of Sino-India Relations During COVID-19 Period. We know that India and modern China emerged after the Second World War. In 1954, Prime Minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru, signed a historic Panchsheel Pact to establish peaceful and cooperative relations with China. However, the benefits did not last long as border dispute other bilateral issues led to the 1962 war between the two countries. As a result, the relationship between the two countries deteriorated. However, a change in foreign policy between the two countries can be seen from the 80s, the relations between the two countries were revived through trade, communication, science, and technology when the then Prime Minister of the India, Rajiv Gandhi, visited China in 1988. In 1990, trade competition between two countries gradually started. China has never been able to accept India leadership, influence, and growth. However, in the national interest, economic relations between the two countries went to quit normally. In late 2019, an unknown disease called COVID-19 spread rapidly from the Chinese city of Wuhan to the rest of the world in the form of a pandemic. China started for trade dispute with the US, and India's close relationship with the US made China aggressive towards India. China's main goal is to weaken India as whole. Meanwhile, Nepal and some other neighbors of India have titled towards China, and this is the national security of India. So the main ways to solve the problem in this situation is two final. Also, a way to peace through high-level talks between the two countries. However, in the aftermath of COVID-19, Sino-India bilateral relations are expected to move in a new direction characterized by more border clashes and political tensions. In today's world politics, two most participated states are India and China. Two countries have had a relation connected since time the immortal, not only because of their proximity to a giant Himalayan mountain, but also neighbors, also after the two states emerged in independent sovereign, when China occupies disputed Tibet and newly independent India felt secure and economic in order to be strong, it is very important to have relationship with China. Although the return to normally came in 1988 with the visit of Prime Minister India Rajiv Gandhi to China, where bilateral agreement signed with the Chinese President Deng Xiaoping on December 22 of that year, even promising the resolve of the border issue national interest. That bilateral relation between China and India have been maintained almost 30 years, depending on the good relations that were establishing in the 1990 during the period of foreign policy between the two countries have revolved around areas that have played significant role in the relations between the two countries. As India, a closely ally of the Soviet Union, collapsed in the 1990, the India shifted to market economy in order to sustain itself for world politics. In order to establish their determined 21st century as the dream Asian century, the two countries pursuit in adjustment policy, emphasizing bilateral trade relations, economic cooperation, and strategic partnership attempts to manage. On September 1993, then Indian Prime Minister P.V. Narasimha Rao visited China, signed agreement, World Agreement on the Maintenance of Peace and Tranquility along the lines of actual control. There are all gaps that can be shown be example, such as 2018-19 trade gap between India and China was 53.56 billion, and 2019-20 that gap was 48.66 billion. The strategic partnerships such as SVM-CVM agreement keeps trade and economic relations normal. Two countries are releasing both moves, improving public relations, improving tourism, signed an agreement on higher education between the two countries in 2006, which India and China agreed to provide scholarships to 25 students each. At the international regional level, United Nations Organization members consider that national interest, security interests, attend G20 summit, present BRICS APEC SCO, which India leadership position, SAG, NAM, BIMSTEC, where China remains an observer, even if it does not have members. So it seems that COVID-19 has played a collaborative role before. COVID-19 has a relation between the two countries. The country could be concerned about the downturn China, large economy due to lockdown, and trade cuts around the world due to COVID-19. All the neighboring states, India Union Health Minister, besides over the World Health Organization, which China has not seen favorably. In addition to the close relationship with the Western media, the India media, Chinese, the government did not. The United States provide a drug called hydroxychloroquine to prevent the virus. A little distrust of a return of India COVID arm from China. Expanding supportive influence at the regional level as well, from Serbia to Bangladesh to India, built a road at Dolatbagh, Punish to World Border 2014, which was the initiated by Foreign Minister Rajnath Singh 2019. Presence of World Health Year Port Fair, road construction, a Gilgit, Pakistan, and intense attacks on the Indian border with the aim of supporting its financially and military, China become more oriented. Suddenly, on May 5, 2020, clashes broke out between the two countries' military force in the Panglong Valley of Ladakh in western sector of Lap. Many were injured and border dispute escalated. Increasing military strength. On the other hand, China has included its own untouched border areas in need of war, which is a distinguished itself from previous friendly and military exchange between the two states. It should be noted here that India won't assert its position as a superpower in Asia while China is busy blocking it. Chinese President Xi Jinping over CPEC project aimed at establishing China as a superpower by 2021, which India opposes Asia, South Asia, South China Sea, Pacific Ocean, the India Ocean, and Arabian Peninsula. It is adopting foreign policy, bringing a geographical location like sea and extra in order to but India, another important larger democracy in Asia. Trying to assert itself as an economic and powerful power, heavily a little late. India influence in world politics through the UNO is significant. Although China has already exerted financial and military influence in countries like BRICS, ASEAN, SAARC, China has made it more dynamic in this situation. Their reconstruction of the Afghanistan important General while from Iran talks in bilateral relation with Australia via video call and sending ships to the South China Sea cooperation with Japan, Taiwan, which basically signifies India emergence as a state instead of China. Again, the government of the India enact a new law on foreign investment, which is to accept all investment proposal from the USA. Other countries, especially the term exciting investment from China, must first be approved by the government of India. China has protested saying it violated the rules of the World Trade Organization. The Indian government also banned 59 Chinese app to protest its data and sovereignty, and decided to launch about 200 of its own app. Although it was being protested by the Chinese foreign minister, delivered the intervention proof, it is clear that India talking initiative to build itself as a self-reliant state on the full benefit of the new foreign policy. The self-reliance that India talking about the current situation is a very good issue for the country, but how unattractive China dependence on Chinese raw materials overly dependent on India and Chinese, there is a lot of debate about what you can do because Chinese products are much
Solomon, we have only two minutes.
Needles to serve the policies of India and its neighbors need to be revised because China has managed to settle the foot with Ati. Thirteen of you from the 40 neighbors, with the exception of India, while India has not been able to settle border dispute with any of neighbors except Bhutan and China, it far ahead. After all, the fact that China is an aggressive state is not be ignored because border conflict between the two countries, 1962. I think it's 2017 Doklam problem. Even in today conflict, China has kept the elite since India adheres to a principle of not attacking first. So India cold heated diplomatic tactics are considered to be the key to success. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Solomon. Bijay sir, hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Sir, you can conclude.
Okay, it is a very good session. We had 6 papers. Basically, the papers deals with the India's relation with its neighbor. There are some specific paper also, India's relation with Bhutan. And overall, India's relation with its neighborhood. It was an amazing session. And we had 6 papers. Out of 6 papers, 2 papers are presented by the students. They have shown very good interest in the field of research. And also present their paper as well. And regarding all these papers, one thing is pertinent about the changes that has been made during the COVID-19 period, basically keeping with the bilateral relation affecting the political and economic relation particularly. So India's foreign policy changes particularly affecting the countries in which India has a better relation, like Pakistan and China. So India has pressure to deal with such issues and diplomatic strategy or diplomatic behavior of India had to be rectified so that the issue will be betterly dealt with. Regarding the old issues which affect the strain and stress between the relation among the neighboring countries, so India had to develop a good bilateral relation with the neighboring countries so that India would be secure and prosper for the future. Thank you, Satyajit.
Thank you, sir. First of all, I would like to thank all paper presenters, and we have had a very informative session. Especially, I would like to thank my teacher, Dr. Bijoy Kumar Das. Thank you, sir, for delivering a lecture and chairing a almost two-hour-long session back-to-back. I have more 3 minutes to go before the next session starts, sir, I have a query to you, sir, regarding your paper. There is a growing feeling that the government of India is exercising absolute power in order to combat the pandemic situation. And you have also mentioned it in your paper. Although India is not authoritarian by nature, and there is also a speculation that with the outbreak of pandemic, the state is gaining the character of a majoritarian state. And keeping it in mind, do you think, sir, that the exercise of absolute power by India by the government of India is a response to pandemic? Just it is a response to pandemic, and it will be a short-lived experience.
In every emergency situations, the state become very absolute, and the state become unlimited. So, how to roll back to the actual position? That also a question mark. So, India will be rolled back to the basic original status after the pandemic is over. That is also a question mark. So now we are visibly marked the functioning of the state in a very authoritarian manner, and the decision making process in this context is very centralized, and the state is everything in deciding what to do and what to not do. So in future, after the pandemic is over, the original position of the state may be rolled back or may not rolled back. How much time will it take? That is a question mark also. But presently, in dealing with the emergency situation, the state tend to be little bit authoritarian and little bit undemocratic also.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And thank you, sir, for being with us. And
thank you, Satrajit, and thank you, the Department of Political Science, for organizing such a wonderful webinar in the context of India's domestic and international relations, restructuring India's domestic and international relations. It was a very pertinent topic in this context, and the Department of Political Science, Bankura University, has taken a good initiative to organize such a wonderful seminar. I thank the organizer, all the organizers, and the teachers, the students, all these staffs for organizing and contributing in this respect. Thank you, Satrajit.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. And we are moving to the next session of this day. That is the second session of this day. And it is also another technical session. That is technical session number 6, I think. And this session will be chaired by Dr. Shekhar Shil. Dr. Shekhar Shil, are you there?
Yes, I am here. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Satrajit, and thank you, Professor Dr. Bijoy Kumar Das, for your illuminating speech. I would like to thank you, and thank you for your speech, sir. It was really wonderful. Thank you, sir. Thank you. So we are heading towards technical session 6, and Professor Pranada Bhattacharya here. Professor Pranuta Bhattacharya, are you here?
No, she is not online.
Okay. So, without wasting many time, if she could join us, so it will be wonderful. She is a co-chair with me. So, without wasting time, I would like to ask Dr. Badur Sarkar at the department. And his topic is Corona. I would like to ask Dr. Badul Sarkar to present his paper, and please confine yourself within 8 minutes. Dr. Badul Sarkar, are you here? Yes.
What I have done in the earlier session, that check who are present, who are not.
Okay.
Sure, that who are there online or who are not. Then you can accordingly call them.
Still, I have to. Yes, that's right. Okay. I think he is not present. Present. So in that case, I would like to ask Pobitra Kumar Bormon.
Yes, sir.
I think he is present.
I am present.
Yes. Please. Please start your journey. Please start your reading your paper.
Okay, sir. Respected chairpersons, all dignitaries. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Please. You are audible. No problem.
Respected chairpersons, all dignitaries, and my dear participants, thanks to all of you. I am going to deliver my lecture on my topics. My topic is India's foreign policy in global politics during COVID-19 pandemic. India has influenced not only South Asia but the entire world. It is now a developing state. However, in the current context of change in the international situation, India's foreign policy has changed. India's foreign policy has taken a new shape after a long evolutionary path. Jawaharlal Nehru is referred to as the architect of the foreign policy of independent India. Nehru held the roles of Prime Minister and Foreign Minister at the same time. He made all important decisions regarding foreign policy. Pandit Nehru was influenced by Mahatma Gandhi. India's foreign policy is a reflection of its recognized political values. From ancient times to Mahatma Gandhi, various scholars have preached the message of brotherhood, peace, and international harmony. It is also reflected in the Constitution of India. India believes in principle of peaceful approach and mutual cooperation in resolving international disputes. The main goal of India's foreign policy is to resolve all disputes on the path of peace instead of war and to maintain harmony with other states. Jawaharlal Nehru was the founder of the idea of non-alignment movement. On April 1954, the Panchsheel policy was adopted to determine Sino-Indian relations. India always is against racism, imperialism, and war. It believes in disarmament policy. India views regional cooperation as a key part of its foreign policy and non-alignment movement. The name of SAARC can be mentioned in this regard. India's active support in the war against colonialism can be clearly seen. In this context, the liberation of wars of Vietnam, South Africa, Namibia, Angola, Mozambique, and Congo can be mentioned. At present, India and China are two of the most influential countries in Asia in terms of international relations. China is a powerful state. As a major power in South Asia, India has established itself in international politics. On the platform of the United Nations, India has raised various issues and demands of the Third World. India was unrivaled in the Third World leadership. India is playing a significant role in the movement for economic and political sovereignty in the Third World. Recently, India has been elected a temporary member of the Security Council of the UN. India has been pressed in the international arena for helping many countries around the world, including the United States, with hydroxychloroquine medicine to prevent corona. In recent times, good relations have been established between the USA and India on various international issues, including the corona crisis. On the other hand, China has not taken a good look at the issue of USA's friendly relations with India. we think that China is betraying India in various ways. As a result, China has created Galwan Valley crisis with India at present. It is alleged that the People's Liberation Army of China violated the line of actual control in the Galwan Valley. The Indian Army fought valiantly and resisted the People's Liberation Army of China. China has repeatedly tried to violate the line of actual control. This is a sign of China's aggressive attitude in violation of international agreement. 20 Indian soldiers were killed in the incident. On the other hand, more than 40 Chinese troops were killed in that struggle. India strongly protested the incident. Many countries around the world strongly condemned China's aggressive behavior. Later, Indian Defense Minister Rajnath Singh took a decision in favor of Indian soldiers that the soldiers have right to use gun in any difficult situation along the Ladakh border. Despite the fact China has deployed troops with weapons on the Ladakh border, on the other hand, India has also deployed large numbers of troops along the Ladakh border with weapons to respond appropriately. Diplomatic talks have temporarily calmed the tensions between India and China. India has made some changes in its domestic policy. As a result, 59 Chinese apps have been banned by India. Later, 47 apps have been banned. And in future, 250 apps can be banned by India. China wanted to form an anti-Indian forum with Nepal, Pakistan and Afghanistan to pressurize India recently. Make in India policy was launched by Modi government. Atmanirbhar Bharat is the vision of Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi, of making India a self-reliant nation. It is very difficult to maintain peace in South Asia without talks between India and China. Indian foreign policy is currently facing challenges. India has to take some responsibilities. India has to deal with corona. India has to bring economic development. We have to maintain friendly relations with the neighboring countries. In the interest of our country, diplomatic relations with different countries should be maintained. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay. Have you completed?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Please stay with us and we are coming back after present after listing all the papers.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Now I would like to request Dr. Najmul Hussain Lashkar.
Yes, sir.
I would like to request Dr. Najmul Hussain Lashkar. Are you here?
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Okay, I can hear you. Okay. Yes, you are audible and I also can hear you. Okay, Dr. Najmul Lashkar. You are assistant professor of Goldmoho College in Portugal. Your topic is China-US relations, COVID-19 perspective. Please, sir, start.
Okay, at the very outset.
Please start your paper.
Okay, sir. Respected chairperson and other viewers, good afternoon to you all. At the very outset, I extend my heartiest thanks to the organizer for organizing this 3 days long wonderful webinar and giving me an opportunity to present my paper on Indo-US relationship during COVID-19. Well, all of us know very well that COVID-19 pandemic has impacted various facets of our life. It impacted our economy, society, polity, and whatnot. Undoubtedly, COVID-19 pandemic has brought a gigantic change in the global political atmosphere also. And we are expecting that a new global world order will emerge in the aftermath of COVID-19 pandemic. Well, at the title of my paper, as the chairperson told, the China-US relations COVID-19 perspective. In this paper, I have taken a modest attempt to understand and explore the possible impact of COVID-19 on China-US relationship. As we all know very well that since the Second World War, we had noticed the relationship between China and US is almost a bitter relationship. It was fully based on mistrust, competition, anger, and so on. I mean, now also, it still continues, and it is expected and it is believed that in the aftermath of COVID-19, the relationship between US and China will become much more bitter and harsh that the world has never faced. Anyway, the COVID-19 pandemic has revealed the drawback of big political giants and inability of the USA to handle the pandemic effectively. It clearly uncovered the fact that big global powers failed miserably to find out defense mechanism to deal with the pandemic successfully. At this crucial juncture, China is expecting to fill the power vacuum and fly in supplies to every nation in Hungary. But does the world community really trust upon China, really trust China? It's a million-dollar question. I think surely not. To a certain extent, China is isolated now. We have to understand that China is isolated. Various countries have already isolated China and they are not ready to maintain cordial relationship with China. So it becomes very tough call to say who will be the key players in the post-COVID-19 global politics. It will also largely depend on how quickly the world recovers from this economic crisis. China is the nation from where the coronavirus pandemic originated, and the country had tried to play down the economy of the the economy of other countries. Accusations against China are plenty, and US mainly President Donald Trump has even warned it if proven that it had knowingly let loose the virus on an unsuspecting world. COVID-19 had its origin in the Chinese city of Wuhan, and the country has been accused of trying to hide the magnitude of the disease when it was first reported in December last year. In fact, the big powers are on the line of fire. It is believed that the geopolitical competition between the US and China will escalate. There is no doubt about that. Undoubtedly, the impact of COVID-19 will reveal that geopolitical rivalry between the US and China will increase, will strengthen, and will escalate. It becomes very clear when we find that US President Donald Trump has already begun questioning the liberal global order from within. At the same time, the Chinese President Xi Jinping also bid adieu to the age-old foreign policy dictum laid down by Deng Xiaoping. Deng Xiaoping's main foreign policy tactics was hide your capacities and bide your time. And in return, Xi Jinping took a bold and strident role in global politics. China is very much confident to extend an alternative model of Western capitalism. China is also expecting to replace the US and secure the place of number one in economic as before. Lots of changes will occur in world politics. Many scholars even argue that we are now on the transition of a new world order in which the forces of uninterrupted globalization process will give way to the forces of protective nationalism. The state will emerge as a key player in the post-COVID-19 world politics. Certainly, it will have a great impact on China-US relationship also. After the pandemic gets under control, Chinese and American models of global governance will be in a fierce competition. And this competition will be more about good governance practices in such different realms as health, sustainable development, environment protection, climate change, poverty reduction, so and so forth, then military power capacity and territorial control also. Put differently, both powers will increase their efforts to sell their national narratives around the globe and try to recruit as many followers as possible to their cause. So in nutshell, what I can say that in the aftermath of COVID-19, the world politics will re-emerge in a new fashion. Globalization will certainly set back, and the nation state will emerge as the key actor in the international politics. It doesn't mean that globalization will rebound or return back to the pre-globalized phase. Globalization is there and it will be there, but we may face, or we may, what is my take or assumption is that we may find a new type of new pattern of globalization which will be more cooperative, which will be more humanistic, which will be in a new fashion or new form, unlike the traditional so-called Western model of globalization. Thanks to all.
Thank you. Thank you, Hussain Lashkar. Thank you. Please stay with us. We are coming with capitalism.
The environment will become riskier, online crime will grow, while the possibility of major cyber attacks, also including on critical infrastructure, will increase as geopolitical competition rises. Now, if I have to give a summary of this, I must tell you that US-China frictions have not been absent from the COVID-19 crisis in Europe, as well as in the multilateral level, for instance, within the G7. Now, European countries have resisted the confrontational language and stance of the Trump administration. So, yes. And the COVID-19 crisis, as we all know, it has had several aspects of humanitarian aid, development, and peacekeeping, and the fight against disinformation and cyber attacks. So we must also deal with this. I mean, we must make governments, we must vote people. And I think, yes, here I want to end. Government should, look after these issues as well.
Lopamudra, please try to conclude.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Lopamudra. Do we have any other presenter left? Any other presenter left? Okay, fine. No one is left.
I don't think so.
Dr. Shin? Would you
Thank
like
you.
To say something?
Thank you. We have nine... At the very outset, we had nine paper presenters, but up to now, there are five presenters who have presented their papers. Before I comment anything, I must say China occupies the central position in world politics. So I don't know whether it is true or not. But say China holds the world. Even China didn't thought that whether he could get such prestige and power in the world politics due to Corona. But the reality is, and according to the paper presenters, according to the paper presenters, China really occupies the center character of the world politics. But the point is this, that I am very impressed with the issue raised by Dr. Najmul Hussain Lashkar, and who tried to say that on the necessary changes at the theoretical plane. Obviously, he is a very young scholar. He would definitely think about this aspect also. But what are the possible changes could be taken place in theoretical plane? This is one of the most important aspect when you are going to deal with this situation in a theoretical manner. And the last is this, that Shongomit, Lopamudra Ghosh.
Dr. Shil, you're not audible.
Okay. Am I now?
Yes.
I am now?
Yes.
Okay. But on the other hand, Lopamudra Ghosh, and when she spoke about European Union, I have only made myself very clear about my observation. So, Pranota, if you want to say anything on this.
Yes. I do not have any particular question to any speaker, but I have suggestions for some of the speakers. Probably I missed Badul Sharkar's paper I missed, and
COVID. Badul Sharkar did not.
Okay. So Najmul.
Badul Sharkar didn't.
I started from Najmul Lashkar, so I heard you for a while. And I found your paper very interesting. I think you have mentioned about ASEAN, because the focus is on US-China, and I'm very glad that you focused on something other than the US-China, the EU. So thank you so much. Safety list on coronavirus. Okay, please try to focus on that. I don't know whether she is listening or not, but she is taking up a very ambitious plan. So I think she can focus on these issues. So moreover, all the papers are very interesting, but I expected some focus on other rising major
powers,
not only U.S.,
powers,
China,
yes.
The enterprises like Japan, Singapore, and also the Asia-Pacific region. I think Asia-Pacific region was, neglected in this session, probably due to the, lack of if other speakers, those who are not there with us, maybe for that reason. Okay, I'd like to conclude and wish you all the best. Thank you so much. Dr. Sheen, any comments?
Thank you. Thank you, Pranata. No, I just thought that before, when we are student, it was a famous phrase that China don't want to be a part of a great nation's politics. At that time, there was a bipolar politics, and that's why, and China declared bipolar politics, and she don't want to be a great the prestige of great. But now China, I think, has been changed, that China is now considered to be a great power, and China wants to be a great power, whether it declares or not. But China is a great power in terms of its influence, in terms of its both in soft as well as a hard power, and both in a soft power. So I think that the world politics will be revolve the US or US versus others, US and others versus China. I am not very sure, but China and US will occupy the center stage in world politics rather than anyone else. But I think that here lies the most important question on the stand of Russia, because we all know that Russia in all and all is considered to be a hard power. So Russia, what Can you hear me?
Yes, you are audible. Please tell me.
Okay. So I don't know what should be the because Russia soft power. It is a hard power in every sense of Russia's stand regarding this particular crisis and in post COVID world situation. So being like this, because these issues are genuinely related with our day-to-day life, but this day-to-day life ultimately, and these issues, and by reflecting our day-to-day life, these issues ultimately affect the very process of politics, the very process of democratic polity in our country, or everywhere in the, or not only in our country, but in every respect, the democratic polity in true sense of the term. Now, what I'm trying to say? Now, when we have started our journey as an individual, we are celebrated within the notion of somehow or some way, we have detached ourselves from our community. We have celebrated the famous individual understanding about life. We have celebrated the individual understanding of thought. We have celebrated the individuality. But in celebrating these individual understanding of life, individual understanding of self, we perhaps detached ourselves from our community. And this is going on for last couple of centuries since the advent of modernity in our life. Now, but if we look at the nature of this individual-centric approach of life, the famous term which has been coined by many philosophers, that is, we are celebrating the atomistic being. We are celebrating our atomistic selfhood. That means we are no longer able to connect ourselves with our group, with our neighbors, with our immediate communities. We are celebrating the atomistic being of life. Now, what is the fallout of this atomistic being of life? Now, in our mostly in our urban situations, we are no longer able to connect ourselves with our fellow beings. We are not able to effectively connect it with our fellow beings. Why? Because we are always thinking in terms of our own being. Theoretically, what I'm trying to say is this, that Macpherson in a 19th century context, in second half of the 19th century context, celebrated in his work, coined the term of possessive individualism. But this possessive individualism was somehow sometimes things in the name of enjoying our space. So this is one of the situation. But now, when COVID crisis is come around us, when we are falling in this COVID crisis, when we are suffering from this COVID crisis, this kind of unconnectedness among ourselves, the detachment of ourselves with the fellow beings, detachment with our neighbors, detachment with our other extended family members, detachment with even we are no longer able to connect our next two person, that means husband no longer connect with his wife, or wife is no longer connect with his husband, because we are all celebrating the famous notion of isolation. Now, what is the ultimate political implication of this isolation? Now, here I would like to bring the notion of space. What is most unfortunate, what is painful for us, that is that in many occasions, many persons, they are trying to justify, they are trying to relate, they are trying to identify this isolation with their larger community, with their larger society, with his fellow person, even within their family. This kind of isolation has been identified, or they are trying to identify this kind of isolation, detachment, as a individual space. Or in other words, the isolation is for him or for her is a kind of space where nobody should enter. In other words, that in the name of maintaining her own space, in the name of maintaining his own space, nobody should not encroach that space. But the point is this, that in the name of enjoying their space, in the name of enjoying their own sphere, they are trying to identify space with a kind of isolation. So when just for giving an example, I am really bothered to hear that when a husband say that this is my space and there is no one who should encroach this space, even not by my wife, or kind of space from which we can raise question against the state. We are not able to create any kind of space from which decent voices could be emerged. So whatever we are practicing in the name of maintaining individual space, that is essentially a kind of practicing of isolation, practicing of atomistic selfhood. Rather, we are not being able to create a space which will be substantive and which will help the individual citizens to raise their voices against any injustice from the part of state. So state is something which is now going to be a dominating. Why? And this is going to happen because that there is nothing as such which could prevent state from shift from authoritative attitude or expressing their authoritative attitudes. This is a very, very important and it is the, it has the very negative implication for the democratic polity, because the space from which we could start our journey to restrict states, that space is no longer there. The in the name of individual space, we have celebrated the isolation. So not so this is the thing, and in view of the democratic polity, in view of the relevance of the democratic in view of the dissent voices which need to be addressed in a democratic policy, in view of the protest against the injustices in the context of democratic policy, that all together will be suffer a very bad suffer a setback in near future, because we are what we are practicing for a large amount of time, restrict ourselves within our own isolated periphery. So the thing is this, that from family to locality to community, we are not able to create any kind of space from which we can ask the state.
Are we in this situation? Is the COVID-19 situation, can we see this as a given physical reality? Sorry, any problem?
No. Problem. I have no problem.
It looks like you are talking that COVID-19 situation is creating a kind of given physical reality, which is sufficing the space, and we are cut off from the collectiveness, the collective space, and we cannot create a buffer against the state. But can we tag space as a just given physical reality, cognitive mapping of space? What is your take on that? Do you feel that cognitive mapping doesn't matter here? Only the physical reality matters here, or the physical connectivity, or the physical spaces? Those are important, not the cognitive mapping or the cognitive imageries of space. That's not important. What's your take on that?
Any other? Okay, thank you for Pranota for your question. For me, that community mapping or sense of belonging, fine. If I realize that you are my part of my community, if you are my part of my community, or if you are or you are part of my larger family, that is okay. I'm not saying anything like that. family or with his community in general, because this kind of sense of belongingness otherwise put in a very, very negative repercussions for not only for the society or individual relationship, but it has the most important repercussion, negative impact on the issue of political process of political process in general.
Yeah, I'm present. State, with a focus on the liberty versus surveillance debate. Now, when I talk about the changing paradigm which has resulted from COVID-19 pandemic, we all know that it is something which is unprecedented. It will be very cliche to say it again, but we know that it's extraordinary in its rarity. It's a black swan event, if I may say so. And throughout the world, across nations, the political response, the response to COVID-19 has been varied. But one thing is common, which is also common in India, an increased invasive surveillance from the part of the state, which is very evident when the national lockdown was announced after March 22nd, I think on March 24th. It was in a matter of few hours' notice, without taking into consultation various states across India, and there was a clamping down on press freedom. We know that just before few hours before the lockdown, there was a video conferencing called by the Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi, and he asked all the media houses to be very positive regarding covering the news on COVID-19 pandemic. This is something which is exemplary. And when we talk about the right to privacy against the background of surveillance measures, we know that various states across India, for example, Karnataka, if we talk about Telangana, if we talk about various other states like Jammu and Kashmir, various measures were taken to trace and track citizens, which as per public health surveillance is not wrong. But the way it has been done is something which is really unprecedented. And we know about the Arogya Setu app, which was launched by the national government, and it encourages you to actually to keep the Bluetooth and the GPS on to trace you, track you, and there is supposed to be a self-assessment survey. So all these measures which were taken is something which questions one thing, which is that, is this infringement legitimate, constitutionally justifiable? And if not, then what is the result? What we should do? How much the citizens are ready to sacrifice their civil liberties? To what extent? In order to endure this public health surveillance measures? These are two very important questions which bring us to the fundamental right to privacy, which was previously not, but we know after the Puttaswamy judgment, privacy judgment of the Supreme Court, it is an inalienable part of the right of citizens. It is a part of right to personal liberty and life. And along with that, the right to freedom of movement and right to freedom of speech and expression. So every citizen has right to informational self-determination. That is, he or she knows how much she is going to reveal, and no government can take away this from the citizen. So this is very important. And as far as we know of two very important scholars like Y.N. Harari and Frank Snowden, this kind of surveillance measures are supposed to be permanent. Whenever we see governments taking surveillance measures, what happens is that this data tends to be stored in government records, and they permanently, there is a tendency to store it permanently. which Harari calls under the skin surveillance. When we, history also proves that if we talk about the bubonic plague in England, that time also there was emergence of modern absolutism, waiving of civil liberties, which is dangerous for public citizen empowerment. So there is always a fear that liberty may be snatched away. Through, and with that, with the coming of COVID-19 pandemic, there is a we all know there is an anti-globalization surge, and we are finally seeing a justification of the theory of Stiglitz, who wrote in Globalization and His Discontents about this global threat of globalization. So we are seeing that coming true, and the state through the coercive measure of the state. What is very, very alarming and terrifying is that the state is tending to collaborate with the tech giants, which we find in the writings of Naomi Klein, who wrote in Disaster Capitalism about the shock therapy, and she clearly said about this, and the fear of this new screen deal. Everything is becoming this no touch therapy is going on in this world, and this may be very, very terrifying for citizen empowerment. This surveillance may stay on, which is something to be very feared about, because there is no statutory framework or personal data protection law. Though there is a bill which was tabled in Parliament last year, it hasn't become law, which mandates the privacy of citizens as primary for any data to be stored in the for the government in government files. So this is something which also the leading intellectuals of the 21st century, Zizek, talks about in his book The Pandemic, that this can spell doom for individual liberty, this kind of collaboration of the tech giants with the state. And surveillance measures can really, really be very invasive. What is very alarming again is also the stigmatization attached to it. Because when you are naming and shaming people, putting up notices in front of their houses, then what happens is that they are getting ostracized. They are getting evicted from rented apartments. We know about stories how nurses have been mistreated and maltreated in Calcutta. We also know about how in Northeast they have been, very much because of their Mongoloid features, and because it, information is getting revealed about them, how people have been very much ill-treated. So this is something which is very, very terrifying for people, for citizen empowerment. But the hope is that citizens across nations, especially in India, they are taking a note of what is going on. Awareness level has increased a lot. People know how the government is taking forward various directives, and they are aware. They are getting more aware because of the rise of social media platforms, and all information amongst fake news also we get to know everything. We can get to know what's real that's going on. So this is something which is very very something to be hopeful about. And privacy, the right to privacy, stands among all the surveillance measures. And this can be very, very good for citizen empowerment. Citizens can come forward, and they can resist. This kind of resistance can develop through various civil society groups, various forums, which is happening throughout the country. I think I have ended my speech. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Please stay tuned with us for our discussion.
Okay, thank you.
Jhartha, would you like to speak?
পরে বলবে না আগে তোমার প্রেজেন্টিং দেখাচ্ছে নির্ঝরদা ইউর তোমার প্রেজেন্টিং দেখাচ্ছে উড ইউ লাইক টু প্রেজেন্ট রাইট নাও আনমিউট ইয়োরসেলফ
হ্যালো হ্যালো মাই অডিবল
ইয়েস
ইয়া আই এম সোমালি
ওকে নেক্সট সোমালি মুখার্জি ডক্টর সোমালি মুখার্জি অ্যাসিস্ট্যান্ট প্রফেসর ইয়েস নির্ঝরদা তোমারটা প্রেজেন্টিং হচ্ছে তোমারটা প্রেজেন্টেশনটা বক্তব্য
এত বলছি না মানে এখন আমারটা হবে নাকি যিনি বলছেন
ওনারটা পরপর যাচ্ছে পরপরটা পরপর হচ্ছে ঠিক আছে
ওকে তো আমারটার পরে হবে তাই তো
ঠিক আছে ঠিক আছে
না না আই জাস্ট ওয়ান্ট টু আস্ক আই জাস্ট ওয়ান্ট টু আস্ক লাইক হোয়াট দা অর্গানাইজারস উড সে বিকজ আই এম অলরেডি প্রেজেন্টিং সো আই ডোন্ট নো
তোমার এখানে প্রেজেন্টিংটা আসছে
না না বলছি আই মিন লাইক অ্যাকচুয়ালি আই থিং দেয়ার ওয়াজ সাম নেটওয়ার্ক প্রবলেম সো আই কুডন্ট হিয়ার হোয়াট দি organizers had to say so am I supposed to present right now or will
no so but this is going by the schedule this is okay, going okay. by the schedule all
right
please check the schedule okay
thank you sorry
Dr. Shomali Mukherjee
yes hello
assistant professor yes assistant professor department of political science Gurudash college Kolkata her paper is COVID-19 and the changing face of Indian state some critical reflections floor is over to you madam
can you please ask Mr. Mukherjee to switch off his presentation
yes, right
well good afternoon everybody I am Dr. Shomali Mukherjee from Gurudash College Kolkata and today I'll be speaking on COVID-19 and the changing face of Indian state Well, madam, I have a PowerPoint which I would like to share with everybody. So, I'm starting with your permission. The center had imposed a nationwide lockdown from March 24th, 2020. The opposition states were particularly singled out for criticism for their handling of the pandemic, despite the BJP ruled states like Gujarat faring extremely badly. There was concerted effort by both the central and the state governments to show that the number of infections and fatalities were extremely low. The way the crisis was handled was itself intensely political. India's federal structure witnessed severe political and financial strain. Well, despite whatever PM Modi might be saying about cooperative federalism, all his unilateral policy actions, his populist appeals, his government's bullying of state governments are in fact a part of the political narrative aimed at retaining his dominant position in the national politics. There were food grains which were supposed to last a year for the laborers, but the plan of one nation, one ration card system remained very ambiguous and we witnessed a lot of corruption especially in West Bengal there was mudslinging between the states and the center now union list allots the legislative field of interstate migration and quarantine to the center the state list allots public order police public health sanitation hospitals to the state the concurrent list allots the social security social insurance employment unemployment and prevention of diseases to the both center and the states. The subject area of disaster in all the three lists of the schedule are not defined, which is leaving the center to use the residuary powers. In 2005, the center...
Sorry to interrupt, Dr. Mukherjee. Do you have only one slide?
No.
Sometimes it's not... Okay, fine. Now it's fine. Okay.
In 2005, the center had enacted the Disaster Management Act which derived its power under entry 23 of list 3. Under section 2 of Disaster Management Act, the national plan was supposed to be made in consultation with the state governments. However, we see at the onset of the lockdown, the central unilaterally clamped the lockdown without consulting the states and without any long-term plan. The states have also been using their power under the Epidemic Diseases Act 1897 or EDA for issuing regulations mandating the observance of lockdown. So both DMA and EDA show that states have the primary role in pandemic situations, while the center should be acting like a guardian, framing policies, guidelines, and monitoring the situation. The action of the center in subsuming all executive and legislative functions in itself is extremely, it's not really praiseworthy. Now coming to the context of fiscal federalism, as you all must be knowing, that the states earn their revenues through GST, sales tax, and the excise duty. Around 2/3 of the revenue are transferred directly from the center. The GST suffered badly when the state when the center initially closed the liquor shops. The cess levied on coal, tobacco, and other products like automobiles, aerated drinks have also been severely affected, hampering the already crippled state economy. The center is making the cord between the states and companies look extremely ugly. Now, we have a Companies Act 2013, which provides a list of corporate social responsibilities for the company. At present, two clauses are relevant, that contribution to Prime Minister's Relief Fund or any fund set up by the central government for socio-economic development and relief of SC/ST OBCs, they are subject to getting tax relief and also disaster management, including relief, rehabilitation, and reconstruction activities.
Your slide is not visible.
Are you seeing? Are you getting to see it?
No.
Just hold on. Slide is not visible. Okay, I think there's a network problem, so you'll be just seeing it in a moment.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So I'm just continuing with my presentation. Prime Minister's National Relief Fund, Prime Minister's Citizen Assistance and Relief in Emergency Situation Fund, which is now known as the Chief Minister's Relief Fund, the National and State Disaster Management, all should be falling within this tax relief criteria as they fall within the ambit of disaster management. However, the Ministry of Corporate Affairs has created confusion about the center's intentions, as it includes PM CARES for tax relief, but not Chief Minister's Relief Fund, which makes it less desirable fund to contribute to. Now, the PM CARES has come under a lot of criticism of late. It is a trust which has been created by the center, Prime Minister being its ex officio chairperson. It is managed by the central ministers, and it is audited by a person who is also appointed by the center. So it definitely puts questions on the extent of democracy. Hello? Are you getting to see the slides? Hello?
It is still not visible.
Okay.
It's okay. You continue with your paper. Yes. No issues. We are hearing you.
PM CARES is a trust which is basically, as I was saying, created by the center, managed by the central ministers, and audited by a person appointed by the center. So definitely it puts a lot of question on the extent of democracy, transparency, and accountability associated with it. And it is also not subject to right to information. Now, the conventional modes of transacting politics and rules of governance are also undergoing a huge change. The lockdown and isolation brings into question the continuity of mass collective politics. Familiar means of conducting politics is definitely going to mutate and transform. Electoral processes, both modes of campaigning and voting, will undergo change. Political rallies, as we all must be understanding, will be out of bounds for quite some time, and leaders in political parties will be resorting to digital divide. It might exacerbate the social inequalities, deepening the chasm between the political classes. Now, Jürgen Habermas had said in an interview with Financial Times in 2010 that spontaneous and egalitarian nature of unlimited communication can unsettle any authoritarian government. But the web, mind you, the web does not itself produce any public sphere. Now, at present, micro-level tussles are going to become extremely important. Issues like water, electricity, sanitization. So local leaders are definitely going to gain in prominence. And our democracies at the moment, I feel, completely under challenge. The pandemic is coinciding with increasing attacks on democracy and democratic mobilization. We are achieving public safety, according to me, at the cost of individual and collective liberty. The citizens were given a mere 4 hours notice before India entered into one of the strictest lockdowns. Helpless laborers, bereft of work, shelter, food, and money, trudged millions of miles on foot.
Dr. Mukherjee, please try to conclude.
I was also trying to say that the state is also trying to manipulate the media. The dissenting critical voices are being completely trying to be subdued by the government. And also a particular community is being scapegoated. There is an othering process which is becoming very prominent. And we are witnessing a rising communal polarization. So Lastly, I would like to say we are witnessing a charismatic personality. Like Modi's personality has popularity has risen a lot. He has managed to rally the nation around the flag. And ultimately, I would conclude by saying, what would a post-pandemic Indian state look like? I believe it will have a strong central government with immense power and faith in centralized decision-making. Cooperative federalism is going to be challenged. Democracy definitely under threat. But as I was saying, that the social media or the web cannot be the answer. We'll be witnessing new modes of mass mobilization, which I believe will further marginalize the marginalized. And there'll be a continuity in the majoritarian discourse. And this polarization between religious communities will continue. And definitely the Namo brand of politics is going to be invincible. I don't see anybody challenging it in the near future. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Please stay tuned with us for the discussion after all the paper. Dr. Shoman Ghosh.
Hello.
Dr. Shoman.
Yes, madam, I'm here. Madam, I'm here.
Okay.
Hello.
Dr. Shoman Ghosh, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science, Emory College, Kumbh Mela.
Centralization and everywhere, maybe in Australia and USA, like India, there is a tendency of centralized. There are various type of causes for the centralization tendency, but the crisis like war, fear of war, terrorism activities that push the religion in the centralization tendency, we know, but the pandemic or pandemic corona, it's also pushed to a centralizing tendency because we know this unprecedented, we are not accustomed to that type of this. The it is a tendency of centralization for Indian federal structure. Now the question is that our expenditures are not so. The central government important for some other reason, they totally have to depend on the center for their financial duties to the states, like to proper measurement for sanitization, proper measurement of quarantine, to make quarantine center for their treatment, for their testings. So the states like West Bengal and other non-BJP ruled state, they raised their criticism against the decision of the center because they told that the central government, without consulting, they imposed the nationwide lockdown without consulting them. These types of tendency, I think it is go against the basic fabric of the federal structure of India. And I think
last point in news channel every time. In the issue of continued lockdown, the Indian government neither circulate any clear notice or order to the state government or any prior consultation with the state governments. Only with informal decisions, the central government has announced lockdown. As a result, due to communication gap and cooperation between center and state, the state government has faced a big challenge to control the pandemic situation. Then the common people have been extremely suffering to maintain their livelihood. The government also asks to provide all types of essential service and facilities, but the government last failed to fulfill such responsibilities. Due to sudden lockdown, the panic is building up in the people's mind. The people are rushed to market to stock essential commodities, but lack of supplies, people are not able to collect the minimum needs essential commodities. The Union government should have consultation with the state government about the overall situation before an announced the countrywide lockdown. The Union government only forced to state government to implement their law and order, basically, which is showing the centralizing tendencies of the Union government. Secondly, I explained the issue of declaration of containment zone. Basically, the state government are willing about